to be in Christ is a reality that we have to live by whilst we're on earth. Hallelujah. Come to two other people and say, today is your post-resurrection agenda. And you are not permitted to fail. God can, God will. Does not excuse you, my vocabulary. Because I know God's on it.
The shackles and set the path to freedom.
After all I've been through, the only way out of this is another victory.
Turn send us some rain over in this house today.
Now, experience the bliss of heaven as Pastor Bowale Abrahams of the Spirit. It's time to hear the Word of God according to the pattern.
We thank you for the entrance of your Word is light. Cause me to speak your Word with simplicity and power. Override my thoughts with your counsel. Let my lips speak of your will. Let there be light, let there be illumination and revival according to my gospel. In Jesus' name, we pray that the church say amen. Hallelujah. All right, I want us to turn our Bibles to the Gospel according to John, chapter 10. If you're in John chapter 10, say amen.
Amen.
All right, I want us to look quickly at John chapter 10, verse 22. Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts, walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were there gathered around him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "Did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand." Hallelujah. If you will, you look at verse 34, 33. Let's read verse 31. Again, his Jewish opponents picked up stones to stone him. But Jesus said unto them, "I have shown you many things, many good works from the Father. For which of these do you stone me?" Verse 33. "We are not stoning you for any good work," they replied, "but for blasphemy, because you are a mere man claiming to be God." Verse 34, can we read together? Ready? Read. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law, "I have said you are gods"? And if you call them gods to whom the word of God came, and the scripture cannot be broken. Hallelujah. What about the one whom the Father set apart at his very own hand, right hand, and sent him into the world? Hallelujah. How many of you know that you are not ordinary? How many of you know you are not ordinary? Cannot everybody really believe that? You know, if you notice, not everybody raised their hands. You know, but look at me. I mean, raise your hand and say, "I am extraordinary." Because God is extraordinary. See, I'm created in his image and his likeness. See, whoever sees me has seen God. Hallelujah. Praise God, somebody. Now, one of the greatest hard sayings of the Bible is actually this very part of the scripture, where Jesus had to respond to his deity. and explain exactly who he was to them. And it's unfortunate that till today, even in the church, that is the people that are born again after the death of Jesus, who believed in his death and resurrection. It is funny that we are still struggling with who we really are. We still struggle with our deity as well. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, they didn't understand him. They were offended by his reply, because sincerely, they had been mad about him for a while. But this time around, you know, they didn't understand why he would be that confident to tell them. And if you notice, Jesus didn't really answer the question. You know, Jesus took them back to what they have always believed. And Jesus said, is it not written in your Torah that ye are gods? Hallelujah. Now, Jesus, you must understand, from the beginning of this particular chapter in John's Gospel, had said all kinds of things that I think they should have attacked him when he said that. For instance, he said in John chapter 10, in verse 10, that, you know, that he has come to give life. But before he said that, you know, he said that he is a shepherd. Praise the Lord. I mean, he's a good shepherd. Now, if a pastor walks into this place and say, hi, my name is Good Shepherd, does that make me a bad shepherd? You know, because what that means is that there are bad shepherds, right? They are bad shepherds, and I think I don't need to tell some of you who bad shepherds are. Praise the Lord. Bad shepherds are the shepherds that roast the sheep, fries the sheep, and drink it up with Gary or something. Hallelujah. Those are bad shepherds. And Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. You know, he said, I'm the door. He said, I'm the shepherd, I'm the door, you know, I'm the water. He said all kinds of things. And if I said, you know, he said that the thief cometh to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I have come to give life and to give it to the full. Praise the Lord. You know, he said they come from behind. You see, he was referring to them. They were listening to him, but that didn't really bother them as much as this one. Praise the Lord. Because the moment you raise your head and talk about your Godship, you know, the devil and his religious lords on earth will begin to attack you and attack your righteousness and make you look like you are saying what is not obtainable. Praise the Lord. But when you say, I am a God as a child of God, you are actually not changing or trying to be proud. Hallelujah. You are just stating out exactly the way it is. Look at your neighbor and say, when I say I'm God, I'm just saying it the way it is. Praise the Lord. You know, so he said, I'm the shepherd. Nobody said anything. He said, I'm the door. Nobody argued with him. I'm just fine. Just fine. You know, he said, I'm the shepherd. You know, I'm the door. I'm the water. Remember when, you know, in this same place, he said, I'm the water. Who wants to drink? Hallelujah. So he said all kinds of things. And of course, a good shepherd designation was what should have offended them. Praise the Lord. Should have made them feel bad about something. Like, are you trying to say that we are bad shepherd? But they didn't mind being called a bad shepherd, as long as nobody calls themselves God. Hallelujah. You know, so he said, I know my own sheep, they hear my voice. I mean, somebody should have raised his hand and said, so who are your sheep? List their names. Are you trying to say that we are not, you know? But they never ever fought that, because this particular part of life or reality is one of the hard sayings of the Bible. And that's why we're going to deal with it today. Praise the Lord. You know, so again, today, most churches and most, the atmosphere in the church is saturated with religious doctrines, such that we have allowed the devil to redefine who we are, as long as we are not gods. Hallelujah. Are you catching what I'm saying here? You know, for instance, you know, many believers today who are in the church, you know, can identify, you know, with the scripture when it comes to beautiful scriptures like this that gives us our profile as a child of God. But as long as it's not for them, it's for somebody else, they can shout, praise the Lord. For instance, somebody that has done some bad things comes to the church and somebody still tells him, you are a God. He doesn't want to believe that, praise the Lord. Because the question you and I always have is, if I am a God, then why did that happen to me? I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. If I'm a God, then when I said it, why did it happen? If I'm a God, then why am I going through what I'm going through? If I'm a God, then why is this and that happening? But today we're going to deal with that. Is that okay? Hallelujah. So many Christians, unfortunately, still see themselves and give themselves a profile that is lower than what a God is or what the Bible calls us. Praise the Lord. First of all, you must understand that the Bible calls us gods. The Bible calls us gods. It's not something we made up. It's not something we try to say so that we can sound spiritual. It's not a borrowed profile. It's not something we just, you know, good saying, you know, all these Christians, they just say things. No, it's actually something that God himself, you know, called us. And the devil will fight every other thing. He would be silent when we call ourselves shepherds. He will be silent when we call ourselves dogs. He will be silent when we say we are the water of life. He'll be silent when we say all those things. But the moment we say we are gods, then he begins to fight us. Hallelujah. It's funny because, you know, you see, ironically, in the Garden of Eden, the devil came and said, you know, God knows that the day you eat out of this fruit, you are going to be like God. Praise the Lord. So you see, the devil already knew, you know, that they were already like God, but he was selling to them what you call self-righteousness, performance, or self-effort. Do something to be like God. They didn't realize that they were already like God. Hallelujah. And so, but here, the devil fights, or rather, the Sanhedrin's antagonized Jesus and said, how can you say you are God? Hallelujah. So all we do is teach about our unworthiness. All we do is teach about our sin consciousness. All we do is talk about, you know, the frailties. You know, no man is perfect. Nobody holy pass. And all those things. In fact, some Christians naturally expect themselves to fail because it's not easy to be a man. How many of you know that statement? Or it takes a day. You can't be a man in a day or something. It's not a day's job. You know, we're going to really deal with those things today because those things have attacked your self-esteem according to the scripture. Praise the Lord. And we're going to deal with this low spiritual self-esteem today because somebody needs to get out of this atmosphere of unworthiness. Somebody needs to get out of this atmosphere of condemnation. Somebody needs to get to a point where he says, I got to be myself. No matter what is happening around me, I have to be myself. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You know, so we talk about the punishment of sin and the consequences of sin, and we don't talk about the substitutionary sacrifice of Jesus on the cross as sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. Hallelujah. Now, in John chapter 10 that we read, you know, Jesus had claimed to be the Son of God, you know, but they didn't really get it when he said he was the Son of God. But the moment he said he was Messiah or he was God, they fled up and they wondered, why would you say that you are a God? Because, you know, nobody is God. God is somewhere in heaven. Praise the Lord. But look at you and I say, do you know God is in here? Hallelujah. So the unbelieving Jews, you know, were very offended at his statement. Unbelieving Jews, and you can tell even today, most of the, some people really build a ministry to analyze some of us that are word of faith preachers, especially when we come to this point where we say, I am a God. Praise the Lord. So Jesus came and said you are God, or what? And Jesus said, is it not written in your own Bible? And Jesus was quoting David to them because they believe in Abraham, Moses, David, Zechariah, Isaiah. So you believe that? You believe God spoke to them and you believe whatever God told them is true? So if that's it, then why do you attack me? Because here, the Bible says that God presides in verse 1. It says God presides in the assembly, in great assembly. Please give me King James. God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judged among the gods. Did you see that? Now the word congregation here is not just congregation. Here is like, you've seen the picture of National Assembly where people come together, or what the US called the Congress House, where, you know, they come together and then a bill is passed, right? And then David Mack says, those who say yes, those who say nay, you have to say, that is a congregation. And the gods here refers to, the Hebrew word here is magistrate, all right, or an advocate, or a judge, praise the Lord. You know, so, and you know what they call legislators, right? You know about legislators, and without them, this country is going nowhere, right? You know, because they have to spend time to understand that the laws passed are effective and is working, praise the Lord. Do you understand that? Then the judiciary have to do what, make sure they pass that bill or pass the law and all of that. So what we're saying here is God is talking and he's saying that there, he said the Lord preside, the Lord standeth. The word here is preside. He said in the word, assembly of the representatives, house of representatives, praise the Lord, in the midst of magistrates or judges. He gives judgment among who? Gods, praise the Lord. Now, this picture obviously cannot be God sitting in front of unbelievers, all right? Or sitting in front of sinners, right? He has to be people like him. And you catch what I'm saying? The way you cannot just go to Lagos State House of Assembly and sit and say, yeah, pass the bill, let me know what you guys say. You get what I'm saying? You can do that because you have to be elected. Come on now. You have to be elected to that office, praise the Lord. And the Bible says we've been elected by what is called the election of grace. Hallelujah. We have been adopted into that place because of the spirit of what? Adoption. So we are now in the house of assembly and we are judging with God. Praise the Lord. So this is big because just like David Mack cannot single-handedly, come on now, say, let's ban all the what did they ban again? All the cosmetic shops in Nigeria. Just like he cannot come up and say, I just want it banned. Whether you guys say yes or no, I'm going to ban it. So God is, you gotta understand this. God is saying, whatever I got to do, you have to say yes to it. Some say yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Now, what some of you don't understand is that the devil tries to lie to you and causes you not to see the way God sees you. And that was pretty much what happened in Eden. Eve didn't know who she was. Eve didn't know that she was already like God. Eve could have just said to God, you know, the Bible said he will come in the evening time. You know, he would have just said to God, sir, I wanted to remind you, this tree, what do you think about it? I know you said we shouldn't eat it, but it looks good. What do you think? I said, nah, don't do that, don't do that. Are you catching what I'm saying? You can talk to God like that. See, some of you go pray and you have this slavery mentality in prayer time. You know, we can't do anything to God. You know, unquestionable God. Unquestionable God. But God is questionable. You know, he comes from a religious mindset. I can't question God. I cannot question him. But God said, go look for reasons and let us talk. Hallelujah. So like David Mack, God doesn't just come and say, all right, I'm going to kill everybody in Haiti with an earthquake. No, God doesn't do that. Hallelujah. If when Sodom and Gomorrah was about to go down, the Bible says that God told Abraham, what do you think? What do you think? I'm about to do this. What do you think? Abraham said, nah, God, you can't do that now. All right, you know what? Let me go talk to Lot. Then Abraham goes and talks to Lot and says, you know what? What he needs to do now? God comes about to destroy this place. Lot says, I'm trying. He said, okay, let's pray about it. Praise the Lord. Then he goes and says, Lord, and God said, wait. If you can find 10 people that are righteous, I'll stop. You see God and Abraham talking like that? That is this picture. God is standing like David Mack, but it's not coming with a one-way dimension. He's not coming with this authority because that will make you a slave to him. And that means he himself is a slave because he created you in his image and likeness. So if he created you in his image and likeness, then he has to talk to you like a God. That's why he said, beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. But when the devil came, he said, no, are you the son? He removed the beloved because that just shocks you, make you feel good. Hallelujah. And that's why no matter what you've done, no matter where you are still the beloved of God. Praise the Lord. Nothing can change that because you didn't beg God to put that there. You didn't say, Lord, call me the beloved. No, no. You didn't do that. Praise the Lord. He did it by himself. And that's just sweet. Praise God. That's why I praise his name. That's why I can stand in the place of prayer with all authority. That's why I can say, Lord, what about this? What's going on? I can say, God, you got to stop that. I can say, God, you got to move in that direction. Praise the Lord. Your righteousness brings you to a place of authority with God. Your righteousness brings you to the class of God and nothing else. Nothing less than that. Are you trying to say we're the same with God? No. We are not the God of heaven. No. We are the sons of the God of heaven. We are the sons of the Most High. And because we are the sons of the Most High, we can do what our Father does in heaven. So that it should be true when he said, as it is in heaven, so as it is in heaven, so it shall be done on earth. Then John said, as he is in heaven, so are we here on earth. Now, what does God do in heaven? He's not just getting worship. Hallelujah. He's controlling things. Praise God. Because I say he rules and reigns. That's why you got to rule and reign through righteousness on earth. Praise the Lord. Let your neighbor say, I'm reigning. Say, I'm trending. He said, how long will you defend the unjust? Give me verse 2. Give me verse 2. He said, how long would you defend the unjust? How long would you judge unjustly and accept persons of the wicked? Hallelujah. Did you see that? He said, how long? Somebody say, how long? So he just pictured a David Mack. You know, now remember whatever David Mack, whatever they conclude on, based on the magistrate or the House of Representatives, nay and yes, you know, then they pass the bill to the presidency, then he signs it, and that's it. And you, as a citizen of this country, must abide by it, whether you like it or not. Are you catching this? That's awesome. Well, this is going to be sweet. Just follow me. He says, how long will you defend the unjust? How long would you show partiality to the wicked? I love this because some of us have shown partiality to the wicked and we don't know. Now the word wicked is not someone that you just called wicked before you came into this place. The word wicked is not someone that stepped on your toes. And the person said, so what? So I stepped on your toes. What are you going to do about this? This guy is a wicked man. No, that's not the wickedness. It's not the guy that broke your heart. Hallelujah. Okay, I think that was the wicked guy. You know, but what I'm trying to say is that, you know, the word wicked here actually means unrighteous. Hallelujah. Anytime you see wicked in the Bible is not talking about people's behavior. Because God knew that as at Adam, everybody was wicked. You understand what I'm saying? That's why God is not surprised that, are you serious? He killed his wife and he killed the housemaid? Oh my God. God doesn't, those things don't move God. Praise the Lord. He knows that the heart of man is what? Desperate. Praise the Lord. He knew it. When I believe when he was coming to the scene where Abel was buried, I'm sure God was thinking, wow. But God wasn't moved by that. Because wickedness is the nature of unrighteousness. It's not about them trying to, it's not about you trying to do something good and say, I'm no more wicked. All the bad things I used to do, all those wicked things, I have to drop them. No. That's not being born again. We've said it before that your behavior is not the same as relationship. Hallelujah. Your behavior, you know, does not mean you're righteous. I've seen good behavior, good well-behaved people that are not born again. You know what I'm saying? And I've seen born again Christians. They look like wicked people. You know those math teachers back in the day in secondary school that just hates you to pass because they are from, you know, scriptural union. And just because you painted your nails white, no, colorless, because it prevents something. They don't want to hear it. How can you do that? That's why you cannot pass my class. Praise the Lord. How do you know what I'm talking about? The reason why they can't forgive you is actually because they are born again. They'll tell you over my dead, if I do this, I'm asking for forgiveness. Say, no, If the God that I serve cannot take this seriously, they are defending God. Cannot defend from Shekau. Praise the Lord. So at the end of the day, the Bible says that how long would you tolerate unrighteousness? How long would you tolerate the wicked one himself, the devil? How long would you tolerate evil in your body? How long? Why are you judging them partially? In other words, if you are God, you pass a bill that wipes them off. Not that we have passed the bill in Aso Rock or in Abuja. Then we get to Lagos, we realize that Okada men are still on board. I got what I'm saying. If we pass a bill, then it's a bill and it's got to control everything. Come on, talk to me. If we pass a bill of love unconditional, then we got to love unconditionally. You hear what I'm saying? What if he breaks my heart? You gotta love him unconditionally. What if, you know, you catch what I'm saying? And God is saying, you gotta rise and operate as a God who has already sealed or stamped the bill, and nothing can change that. Now that means that somebody will always do what? Challenge the bill that has been passed. And this is your place as a God to bring that person to book. Praise the Lord. And today we're going to bring to book those small demons that have been operating in your temperature, have been operating in your body, have been disturbing some financial things. Are you catching what I'm saying here? Because we cannot tolerate those people, because a bill has been passed at Calvary and it is yes and amen. Praise the Lord. So we have no reason to participate in recession. We have no reason to participate in those things. Those things will come to challenge our faith, like we said on Wednesday. But we have to learn how to attack back, because the bill has been written. Praise the Lord. So you see why Jesus said, it is written. It is written. Because constitutionally, if it is not written, it's not in power. Praise the Lord. It is not active. Praise the Lord. It does not mean anything. But now that it is written, then I can do all things. Praise the Lord. So if it is not written, then I don't know if you saw one of my posts, that we can talk about the end so beautifully and be confident about what will happen to us eventually, because the end is already written. Praise the Lord. Talk to somebody and say, I know the end of this. See, God is going to get glory out of this. Now he says in go to verse 4. He said, rescue the weak and the needy, deliver them from the hand of the wicked. Now he says in verse 5. He said, they know not, but this is very important. He said, they know not, just like some of us here don't know. He said, they know not. Now he's talking to the magistrates, talking to the guards, all right? And he's saying to them about God, said they know not, neither would they understand. He said they walk on in darkness, and all the foundations of the earth are out of course. This is not the picture of someone that is aware of his Godship. Praise the Lord. When you know that you are God, this doesn't happen to you. But the unfortunate scenario is that most of us are like this. He said they know not, neither would they understand. The religiosity in the church today does not allow most of us to understand these teachings, these harsh sayings about us being a God. Hallelujah. And because of our nature of righteousness, which is the nature of God, then we are like God. Praise the Lord. It's a simple equation, but some people still don't understand that. And when I say understand, not that everybody here will not say I am God, and they will believe it, and they will say it after me. But I'm talking about understanding. Understanding something is to come under it. Hallelujah. Like an umbrella now, when it's raining and you put an umbrella, you see, you don't get wet because you have understood the umbrella. You have come under the umbrella. So it prevents you from getting wet like every other person. You understand that? So now when God says understand, he's not talking about you having a vague intellectual understanding, what they call gnosis, you know, of it, you know, that, okay, yeah, you know, we're God, so we're supposed to be like God, like David Mack. Everybody here will understand that. But when you understand your Godness, you will understand some things. You will know that there are some limits You know that there are some things that have been freely given to you. You know that there are some space that you have yet to occupy. There are some buttons that you are yet to. Everybody will go home annoyed at themselves today because they realize that, so I've been taking all this nonsense and I've been judging and tolerating evil all my life. And I've been trying to tell myself it's just fine. That's the way God wants it. Whereas God expects me to validate anything. That's what your faith is. Your faith is your validation that I've received, I've said yes to what you said. And so because of that, I declare this. Because of that, I decree this. Are you catching this? We are God's. Hallelujah. He says, so they walk on in darkness, and all the foundations of the earth are out of course. They are confused. Hallelujah. And that's what you have in the church. Most Christians are confused about themselves. When he said the foundations are out on the earth, he's talking about out of course, talking about confusion. It's talking about you moving up and down, merry-go-rounding, and you don't know what to do. They tell you you need deliverance, you need deliverance, nothing happened. They tell you you need to be holy, that you stop doing this and stuff, and yet nothing is happening. And you're wondering what is happening. What's going on with me? And you catch what I'm saying here. What is going on with me? And remember, because you are the magistrates, it means that, like America, you judge 52 nations. Are you catching what I'm saying? And like Nigeria, you judge 36 states. Are you getting what I'm saying? So every law passed in just one place, you know, God is going to be at work in every place. Now the Bible says, Paul said about God, he said, it causes us to triumph in every place. So the devil doesn't get more powerful in Africa than he is in America. Right. He doesn't get more powerful in your finance than he is in your body. Are you catching what I'm saying here? If he is powerless in that place, then he is powerless in this place. If he is powerless in the scripture, and a public spectacle was made out of him, then it means that his public spectacle can be made out of him now. Somebody shout now. Yeah. Oh, somebody said, I said shout now. Yeah. So how long are you going to allow the devil mess you up? That's what God is saying here. He said you are confused. Your foundations of the earth, you are leaning as though the foundations of the earth are out of course. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Move to the next verse. This one is sweet. He said, I have said. Who said it? Come talk to me. Who said that? Who said what we're about to read? He said, I have said. Now, have you noticed? The question a student of the word should ask himself is, when did God say this? When did God say this? In Genesis chapter 1 verse 26, let us make man in our own image. Let him have dominion. We have dominion in heaven, so they gotta have dominion on earth. So I have said it. I've said it already. Ye are what? God. Ye are gods and all of you. So you don't get to a realm of leadership before you become a God. You don't get to a point where you have some SOM knowledge and say, ah, you God, baby. But there's something about the child of God at salvation. He is recruited to the royal priesthood, and he can now do things as God on earth. Do you understand it? He said, I have said that ye are, well, all of you are what? The children, praise God, of the Most High God. How many of you have parents here? You have a parent? You have a parent? Okay, I pray that everybody has got a parent, right? He said, ye are what? All of you are children. Now, when you say, I am a child of my father, what that means is that you are connected by what? Blood. Praise the Lord. You are connected by blood. And the reason why, you know, blood is necessary here, and because you can just say, I'm a child of God, and you just stop there. When you're a child of God, the divinity blood flows in you. Are you catching this? The royalty blood flows through you. Your veins are flowing with what? The blood of Jesus. Your muscles are flowing. The blood is flowing with royalty. Hallelujah. And everywhere you are, you have to get conscious of it and say, no, I'm going to take this. If there's anything I know about royalty, they show off. Praise the Lord. And what we need to talk about here is showing off your righteousness. Talk to three men and say, you got to show it up. If you got it, you flaunt it. Praise the Lord. You got it, you flaunt it. Don't wait for anybody. You know, it's fine that the ladies flaunt those things. You know, when they buy that and they buy these and they come to church and they flaunt those things. Praise the Lord. All right, church is the only place I go to often. So I'm not sure of any other places, but I know they flaunt things there. Praise the Lord. You know, just got that shoe, and that's when they cross their leg. Want you to see it. And that's when the ring, maybe the guy just gave them a 15,000 naira ring. Because every other person there using 2,000 naira ring. Is a black man not there? Yeah, one-eyed man, one-eyed man is better in the country of blind people. It's nothing kid. And anytime she's talking, she's just like, actually, why am I even looking at my hand? What did you say? Shallow. I got a girl, his name, her name is so mean, it's Shallow. Hallelujah. My name is Mary, just call her Mary Shallow. Hallelujah. Now, is, I have said that year ago. And what? You are all what? Children connected by blood. Children connected by what? Blood. 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 Now, the guy can be a smoker. He can be a fornicator. Does that change who gave birth to him? I mean, we have changed your identity just because, see, even if you're an American, Nigerian American, you know you are still deceiving yourself to an extent. You know that? We were in the U.S. recently, and I was talking to one guy, and he just came and started doing the old, I'm like, but your name is Bio, right? I'm like, yes, sir, yes, sir. I'm like, so, do you speak Yoruba? So they said, ah, sir, how more Yoruba than you? I'm like, you got what I'm saying? Because I said, be yourself. If you got it, you found it. You don't say, I'm the righteousness of God. Then when somebody broke your heart, your righteousness just disappeared. Then you go around, you just let me see. Am I not good enough? Yes, you're not good enough. Because if you're really good enough, then you should tell me the guy is missing something. Come on, you hear what I'm saying? Well, you call my phone. Let me stop there. I asked, who said it? Was it? Is this Pastor Bowale talking?
No.
Who said it?
God.
Would I be right if I say you are God?
Yes.
Would I be correct?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. You are good students. Because you know that God said it, and you that you are what? God. Now, the Pharisee said he was blaspheming God. Now, is God blaspheming himself here?
No,
Jesus did not say this. Jesus said, have you not read it in this place? That you are what? God. Why are you making it look like a big deal? The moment your deity is questioned, attack. I said, no, wait. What did you just say? What did you just say? Listen, even if you're acting it out, act it out.
Yes.
One of the things I know about kings, they act things out.
Yes.
Especially on TV. They act it out. Act it out. Ours is not about just acting. That's what faith is. Praise the Lord. We act what we believe. Praise the Lord. Don't let the devil lie to you about anything. Just keep fighting. Praise the Lord. You got to fight in your heart, in your spirit. Keep fighting. Some people thought fighting is about you doing something physical. You raise your pants up and say, Lord, today. And you think the Bible and say, Lord, today, every enemy in this house. This is not going to do anything. This is just a novel. Praise the Lord. It becomes a sword of the spirit when it is in your mouth. Are you catching what I'm saying here?
Yes, sir.
What is written has to be spoken.
Yes,
if it's not spoken, then it's not written. Hallelujah. Some of you have big Bibles. You think that's what the devil is afraid of? Some of you have like 7 versions. Say, well, I'm going to read this one to the devil and that one to the devil. By the time I give you 4 versions today. We'll give you 4 slaps. As the children of Sceva. So when the Bible calls you a child of God, it's not talking about a child of, it's talking about one that is connected to God by blood. So when we take the communion, what we're actually doing is we are solidifying our nature with Him. Praise the Lord. Did you hear what I said now? It brings you back to reality that I'm the child of this person. I'm connected by the blood. So when you say, oh, the blood of Jesus, it's not a religious thing. That's why the song didn't do anything to you. That's why it didn't heal you. That's why it didn't touch you.
That's why he didn't give you a word. That's why he didn't bring peace to you when we were singing a song. Because to you, somebody, as far as you're concerned, somebody's singing and you are just echoing what they're singing. That's why we tell people in our church, connect to the worship, connect to the song, connect to the word. Don't just come here looking holy and righteous. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise
God wasn't blaspheming when he said, ye are gods. So where did Sanhedrin hear that? Where did they get that from? Why would they say that I'm blaspheming God because I said I am God? Hallelujah.
We say
I'm the child of the Most High God. Connected by God, by blood. Say his blood is flowing in me. His life is in me. Say his light is my life. Say I'm living the light life. Say I'm living the holy life. Say he said, be holy as I am holy. That means you are already holy before he said it. But some people took Peter out of context and they said, be you holy. And they want you to do something to be holy. You don't do something to be holy. Holiness is not about you doing something. It's got nothing to do with behavior. It's in nature. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 4. He says you are created after God in true holiness. Are you catching this? Don't say I'm created after God in true holiness. So that means there's false holiness. And that's the one you manufactured by yourself. From the factory called flesh. I want everybody to know and the way I talk. Everything, the way they talk is what the holiness is. They talk very slowly and sluggishly. And I could tell God doesn't talk like that because I know God talks like me. Praise the Lord. Yeah, we talk alike. Hallelujah. No, if you have ever heard God speak to you before? Doesn't he sound like me? Praise God. Sounds like me. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That Torah said it. God wrote it down for them because they had one of the consequences of sin is forgetfulness. Because if I can write it, you can see that. Yeah. Ye are what? Gods. You are what? Sons of the children of the Most High. Go to verse 7. This is critical. He said, but ye, look at this. For ye shall do what? Die like what? Like man. I love the translation that says like man. It said you will die like what? Man. And fall like one of the princes. So if you have seen a prince fall before, come on, have you ever heard the prince fall before? Maybe the prince of Saudi or something. Maybe fell into sin or fell into this or fell into that. God is saying it's possible for you to fall because your consciousness of being a God has not been preached enough, have not been accepted by you enough. Praise the Lord. So he says, you will die like man. Look at somebody and say, I refuse that for you. See, that's not going to happen as far as I'm concerned. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, somebody. The law had been so respected and reverenced for over 400 years before Jesus came, that it had made them a slave from within. Because it was about what they did right and what they didn't do right. Because it was about the knowledge of good and evil. And so most of them, even today, even Moses himself got angry. Even Moses himself could not fulfill the law. Because James said, if one of the laws are broken, then you've broken all the laws. So there was pretty much nobody that could fulfill the law. Hallelujah. And that's why Jesus had to come, fulfill it by living spotless. Come on now. And abolished it at the cross. And he said, it is finished. When he said it's finished, what was finished? He's talking about the law. It's no more at work. Regulation is no more going to be the source of righteousness. It's no more going to be you doing something to become righteous. Your righteousness is going to be by faith, which means you don't have to do anything to obtain or to earn the righteousness of God. But the laws had made them a slave, had made them lose their self-esteem of who they were. Praise the Lord. To the extent that if anybody strode around and said, I am God, they attacked the person, even though it is written very clearly in their own Torah that they are what? The God. They are gods. Hallelujah. Praise God, somebody. So Jesus was asking them that, so what do you want me to say? Am I to say the scripture is wrong? So that means that if I say I am not God, I am breaking the scripture. Say, if you say, I refuse to break the scripture. Say, I refuse to break the scripture. Hallelujah. And you know what? This is not just the law saying it. This is Jesus saying it. Praise the Lord. And you catch what I'm saying here? Because this was not a law passed by Moses. This was an establishment from Eden. It said, let us and let them. Let us make man and let them. So God has always expected us to behave like him in situations. That's why he gave us this universe to govern. Praise God. You see, that's why man can go to other planets. Because God gave him the whole place. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
I hear that some people are leaving very soon to the Mars, never to return. That's risky. Because Jesus is not going to return to Mars. Think about it before you do it. Praise God. One of my friends on Facebook said that his a younger brother was shortlisted. I said he's as good as dead. I hope he's born again. Hallelujah. Because the Bible says Jesus is going to appear at the Mount Olive. Praise the Lord. And rapture. Mount Olive is not in Mars or Jupiter. So watch it, scientists. Watch it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now let's see something. Let's go further. Exodus chapter 7. Exodus chapter 7. And I want us to see something very powerful. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
I want us to read verse 1 and 2 together. If you're there, let's read together. Ready? Read. I have made thee a God to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. Let's read that again. One, ready, read. And the Lord said to Moses, I have made thee a God to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. Praise the Lord. So you see, the first time God sends his own to save the children of God from slavery, Egypt was a type of sin. Alright? It's a spiritual place that we were all existing before we got saved. Praise the Lord. So now Moses, who is a type of Jesus, was sent to that place to deliver them through the Red Sea, which is a kind of baptism. Praise the Lord. Now, when Moses was about to go, God had to remind Moses, because God, I don't even know the story from chapter 3. God had shown Moses all kinds of things. Miracles, signs, and wonders. You know, put your hand in your pocket, it got withered. I said, no, put it back, you know. And, you know, he saw God at work, praise the Lord. There was nothing else. You would have thought that was all. But God said, wait. I see, God, to tell you one thing that is very important. I got to give you your profile. Don't go there rolling with Pharaoh like you're begging him. Don't go there rolling and begging Pharaoh like you're, you know, he is the one to save you. He's the one to permit you. Because the bill to leave had been passed in Abraham. You catch what I'm saying? Because the word of God is his bill to you. This word is his bill, his heart to you. What does God say? I don't hear God. Read more Bible, you will hear him. You don't have to hear him like this. Hear him through this one first. Praise the Lord. Are you catching this? So God had told Abraham they're going to be enslaved people. They're going to come out with big stuff. They're going to come out with gold and silver and stuff like that. And when the time came, the Bible says Moses, of course, you know the story at the burning bush, and God said this and that and that. I've heard the cry of my people, even though these people were not praying anything. And yet God said, I've heard the cry. Because God doesn't hear their cry because they prayed. God heard their cry because of his promise to Abraham. God is faithful. Are you catching this? And now God had to make them come out by all means. And the only way you can get those things that you're believing God for, by all means, is not just you praying. It's not just you worshiping. It's you being conscious that you are a God, an authority. The word God here is theos, and it means an authority for everything. Praise the Lord. So you can imagine Moses approaching Pharaoh, even though he was physically in a throne and he had those things on his head and he looked like Ramses. Come on, all right, let us worship Ramses. No, don't be fooled by those bling blings, hallelujah. Don't be fooled by the physical. The devil is the lord of the physical. He has the ability to manipulate the physical and make it look like it is inferior to the spiritual. He can make things and roar in the physical and you would have thought that's the end. If by the time he hits your finance, you would think that's the end of your life. You probably be gasping for breath because he knows how to show off in the physical. When he came, the fruit was blinking and Eve was wondering, wow, wow, wow. And she couldn't resist it because he was full of words, hallelujah. I believe that serpent, you know, the Bible says God cursed him. Then he said, you will be on your belly all your life. In other words, the snake has not always been like that. In other words, the snake had legs. So you can imagine how beautiful he must have been with legs talking to Eve. He must have been one of the most beautiful creatures. Hallelujah. Are you getting this? So he used all those physical things. Come on now. You know, he used all those things to appeal to the woman. Are you catching this? And the woman just wanted to listen to him. He's not the talking type, you know. So if he's saying something, he's got something to say. But that's the manipulation. That is the, you see, he told Jesus, he said, I will give you the kingdoms of the earth. Are you catching this? If you've ever been to kingdoms on earth, you know, you will actually forget the kingdom in heaven. Because it's so beautiful, decorated with gold. And all those Dubai kings, have you seen the way they spend money? And the kind of house they live? Oh my, oh my. One of them put the latest rain sport on a yacht. For what? He said he just loves to be in his car all the time. So he bought a range and put it on the yacht. And they built the yacht to receive that. And he's the only one on earth that can use that. And you know people like that, or people like that just give money to give you a contract. Praise the Lord. You would think, oh, this is heaven. Praise the Lord. But I'm not even. Praise God. And you got what I'm saying? So he loves to decorate the physical, make it look wow. He loves to roar in the physical and say, you, and everybody looks at you and says, there is nothing good coming out of this. But we are superior to the physical because we are from the spiritual. Praise the Lord. The Bible says he framed the world by his word. So the mountain you saw and you loved is not something God molded. Are you catching this? God spoke it into being. And what that means is that we have superiority because we are in the realm of the invisible. Praise the Lord. Are you catching this now? Now, the invisible has been made visible. And it is called the Word of God. The Bible says, we have now seen God. He has spoken to us through his Son. So Jesus now represents the invisible power. Come on now. So each time I put the word in my mouth and I speak the word to something physical, it overpowers the physical because the physical was created out of that which is not seen. What is that that was not seen? Words. Praise the Lord. When I said hi, did you see hi? You didn't see anything, but you knew what I was saying. Praise the Lord. When I say cars, there's no car in here, but everybody can see cars right now. You get what I'm saying? That's the power of words. It creates things that you cannot see. Praise the Lord. Look at someone say, speak those words. Look at two other persons and say, speak those things. Hallelujah. So when the devil, or when the Bible now asks and say, who is man that thou art mindful of him? Now you understand who man is. If man was a stupid, reckless and wretched and hopeless sinner, like some people say they are, we are a pencil in the hand of the maker. Look at someone saying, I'm no pencil. You know, out of this religiosity, we just want to stand humble. No, you know, they think, the Bible says, humble yourself before God. What people actually do is become a slave before God. I say, Papa, what do you mean? And the father said, why are you talking like a slave? Are you crazy? Are you guys what I'm saying? I'm no pencil in the hand of the maker. That's what they say from your hometown. I'm from heaven. Yes, sir. We don't have cultural idioms. Some of you even take cultural idioms to your prayer time. And say, Lord, it's the elders that says that whatever the elders said, you will get results from it, not me. Not from me. Hallelujah. Until you use his word. That's when you are making sense. As people say, fire for 17 times. And after saying fire 17 times, they say, in Jesus' name. I'm like, did we pray? Fire, what were people calling fire for? And that's what some people call prayer. That kind of brother, they say, my brother can pray. That brother can pray. He can pray. Oh, he can pray. Hey. That one has to be there. You know, follow me a lot. Became friends with somebody. I checked out what he was. I'm going to say I was so angry. I was like, why are you angry now? He said, can someone just say, I want to pray. He'll say, start and say, oh Lord. It's part of the ministry. You have to, because people are so foolish and they can't hear what you're saying. They're just feeling that, more. That's what it is. Even when you say Lord tonight in the Bible, and he's quoting, you know, it's not easy to be a man. It's not a Jew's job. You can't hear what he's saying, but you just feel that's all. When he was talking, do you feel? See, goosebumps and it's not anointed. Charisma is not anointed. Anointed is charismata, but it's not charisma. See, that pastor, anytime he gets on the stage, they just say, That's not what brings food to your table. Say, generally, say, I'm not a pencil. I'm not a cat. I'm not a dog. I'm not a pencil in the hand of the maker. The maker is not the designer. His name is God of heaven. He's the Most High. He created the whole world. Because he didn't need a pen. So when did he use the pen? So how come I'm a pen? If I'm a pen, he's a pen. Because he created me in his image and likeness. For the God we serve ain't no pen. Hallelujah. He holds the 10,000 carats of gold. Hallelujah. He said to Moses, he said, don't go there talking like a Moses. He said, don't go there talking like someone, like a prince of Egypt. Nah. He said, don't go there. He said, let those things go. Praise the Lord. He said, change the way you talk to Pharaoh. He said, I am sending you to Pharaoh not as Moses. I am sending you to Pharaoh not as the son or the wife of Zipporah. He said, I'm sending you to Pharaoh not as one boy in the basket. He said, I'm sending you to Pharaoh. He said, I'm not sent to Pharaoh because you have been living in the desert and you have been living in the wilderness and you are going through a lot. He said, no. He said, when you get to Egypt, I can imagine Moses just about to enter the border or the gate of the palace and he dusts his shoes and said, I got to appear like a God. Hallelujah. And when he said, God said, I should tell you, let my people go. You see, that's a God. That's somebody quoting the bill that was already agreed to in the wilderness. God said, will you go? He said, I'm going to go. So they had agreed. Come on now. The God of heaven and the magistrate of the earth called Moses they had agreed. God did not impose it on Moses. God said, I want to save my people. And Moses said, I'm ready to do it. And that's your faith. When you say, Lord, yes. That's your faith responding to the promises of God. But when you go out executing what he has said, you got to raise your shoulder and go in like a fuse, like a deity, and say more and talk like a God. You are made a little lower than God. That's who you are. So in the face of adversity, remember this. Ye are gods. And anytime the devil tries to raise his head, raise that dogs. You better let him know, beware of gods. Put that in your house. Let them know from the physical to the spiritual that you are a God and you have no right to come near. And if you come near the dogs, you know.